Good evening and welcome. For those of you who may not know me, I'm Bob Zimmer. I'm president of the University of Chicago. And it's a great pleasure to welcome all of you here this evening at this very important day for the University of Chicago, namely the inaugural lecture, the grand opening of the Neubauer Family Collegium for Culture and Society. Now, the Neubauer Collegium really grew out of the aspirations of the faculty of the University of Chicago, centered in the Humanities Division, the Social Science Division, for finding a way to transcend certain kinds of discourse. What they aspired to was a venue, a place, to be able to be engaged in looking at large-scale problems which were going to transcend the capacity of any one particular individual to be getting full clarity into it, to be transcending disciplines, to be transcending national borders, to be transcending, in fact, the boundaries of the standard places where humanistic and social science humanistic inquiry was applied. In other words, to be working in environments in which that type of discourse was going to be important and relevant, but where it was not going to be the only type of discourse that was important and relevant. So these conversations went on for some time and became a clearly articulated aspiration of the faculty. So that was the idea. But to turn idea into reality is something else, and we were fortunate to have the wonderful generosity of Jeanette and Joe Neubauer, not for the first time, to embrace this idea and to see the potential that it had for transformation. Joe and Jeanette have been extremely generous to the university in multiple ways, and what you see here in their embracing what is, in effect, a large departure to enable the university to do new things has been very typical of the way that they have thought about their philanthropy in general. So I want to express my personal and for the institution, as well as personal appreciation to Joe and Jeanette for everything that they're doing and enable us to realize these aspirations of our faculty. Now, there's one other thing one needs to realize aspirations, especially in a complicated environment. And I think from the description that I've given to you, you see that this is not an entirely simple thing to make happen. And what one needs is a leader. And we have the great benefit of a wonderful inaugural director for the Neubauer Family Collegium. And it's my pleasure to introduce him now, David Nirenberg.
I've brought a sermon. Thanks, President Zimmer, and welcome to you all. As you just heard, the Neubauer Collegium's establishment was animated by the conviction that many of the most challenging questions we want and need to ask about ourselves and our world require engagement with cultural and social forms of knowledge that the Europeans call the human sciences and we more clunkily call the humanities and humanistic social sciences. Our goal at the Neubauer Collegium is to catalyze that engagement. We have a threefold mission of supporting University of Chicago faculty in their collaborative pursuit of questions that transcend the ability of any one person or perhaps of any one discipline or method, of bringing researchers from around the world, including from around the Chicago centers we're building around the globe, to Chicago to participate in those collaborations, and of disseminating the results of those collaborations back into the world. While all of the Neubauer Collegium projects and programs have the humanities and the humanistic social sciences at their core, many of the difficult questions that our scholars are asking involve movement across academic disciplines and divisions with collaborators from every art and science. So, for example, in our 18 projects that we are supporting in this, our inaugural year, we have faculty not only from 17 departments in the humanities and social sciences, but also from nearly every other school of the University of Chicago. Musicologists are collaborating with physicists and anthropologists in audio cultures of India. English professors are collaborating with obstetricians working on narrative and public health in the Game Changer Chicago project. Film and media professors are working with statisticians and choreographers in cinemetrics. Classicists and archaeologists are working with economists in the working group on comparative economics. And that's just a few examples, four of the 18. And this year, too, we're welcoming a global array of visiting scholars from Spain, Switzerland, Syria, I'm stuck on the S's, China, India, Pakistan, France, Iraq. In fact, just this week, a multi-page story appeared in Al Jazeera about our program on Iraqis intelligentsia. I could spend the entire evening telling you about what the Neubauer Collegium is doing, but that's not why you're here. And a much more inspiring way for me to give you a sense of what we aspire to is to introduce our lecturer tonight, William Kentridge. By introduce, I don't mean tell you about the many exhibitions he's received in storied museums across the world, nor about the operas he's directed in the major houses, nor about the honors and the prizes he's won. Although I would like to add one honor, one prize to the list you can read in your program, and that is one very close to home. In 2006, he received our own University of Chicago's Rosenberger Medal for outstanding achievement in the creative and performing arts. A proper introduction would give you a sense of Mr. Kentridge's work and of its importance. I can't do that. Mr. Kentridge is active across so many domains of culture. He's renowned for his drawings, films, statues, tapestries, mechanical theaters, and opera stagings, among other things. His interviews, conversations, and lectures themselves constitute an important body of philosophical inquiry on the nature of knowledge, perception, and experience. And in fact, right after tonight's lecture, if you like, you can go to the seminary co-op and buy his most recent book, hot off the presses, That Which Is Not Drawn, which is distributed by our own University of Chicago Press. His collaborations are legion, with weavers and musicians, historians and anthropologists, playwrights, puppeteers, physicists, to name just a few. And the resulting works often transform how we feel and think about everything from the politics of the mining industry, the history of apartheid, or the artistic culture of the early Soviet Union, to our sense of time and space, the aging of our parents, even the nose on our own faces. William Kentridge has described his working process as just a hand slowly moving. In making his films, for example, he draws with thick charcoal on paper. He makes a drawing, shoots a frame, smudges, erases, redraws, shoots another frame, slowly building an animated film. And when I say slowly, I mean that if he draws, smudges, erases, redraws all day, he might achieve 10 seconds of film. These films and their underlying drawings have fascinated so many, not only because of their aesthetic beauty and interest, and not only because they are often vitally engaging, even urgent subject matter, but also because of the ways in which they provoke us into consciousness about our ways of seeing, thinking, feeling, knowing, and making our world. His art, if I can paraphrase the poet Auden, turns us all into intellectuals because it makes us more aware of the conditions of our own existence. I'd like to talk more about that working process and about the place of collaboration and movement across boundaries within it, but I'll leave that to tomorrow's event, a discussion with our dear colleague Jane Taylor on what William Kentridge calls the virtues of bastardy, that is, the virtues of working across genres, disciplines, and media. And I invite you all to join that conversation tomorrow, Regenstein Library, 5 to 6:30, room 122. So let me just conclude with just a word about what you're about to experience this evening. Franz Schubert composed the Winterreise at the very end of his life in 1827. It was itself a collaboration of sorts, a setting to music of a cycle of poems by Wilhelm Müller, which was called in the second edition, Poems from the Posthumous Papers of a Traveling Horn Player. In this interweaving of word and music, Schubert was assisted by his frequent collaborator, the baritone Johann Michael Vogel, as well as by his friends who gathered together regularly in what they called a Schubertiad, but we would call a collegium. The song cycle quickly became a focus of attention, not only musical, but also literary and philosophical, because of the ways, not least because of the ways, in which it dramatized how the human subject, in this case the singing subject wandering in a wintry landscape after leaving his love, projects meaning into the world as he moves through it. William Kentridge is at work on a film of the Winterreise for the Vienna Festival, and it is this work he will present to us today. Together with Craig Terry and John Irvin from the Chicago Lyrics Ryan Opera Center, he will explore with us how artist and viewer, musician and hearer, creator and audience all collaborate in producing the meaningful interaction of sound and image. I hope, I trust, I know you can see why we're so thrilled that William Kentridge is here as our inaugural speaker. In his method, in his ambition, in his willingness to take risks, in his energy for collaboration, in the suggestiveness of his world-making and the sheer brilliance of his provocations to thought and discovery, he exemplifies much of what the Neubauer Collegium aspires to. His presence is exemplary of yet one more thing. It represents the Neubauer's important role in the intimate collaboration between philanthropy and culture that is so important in sustaining our arts and our sciences. On October 26th, the Neubauer Family Foundation will be underwriting the simulcast of Kentridge's production of Shostakovich's opera, The Nose, to thousands of theaters around the world. Who more fitting, then, to help us celebrate the opening of the Neubauer Collegium for Culture and Society? Please join me in thanking Joe and Jeanette Neubauer and in welcoming William Kentridge, who will help us to learn what it means to be listening to the image.
Thank you. The expectation of a lecture is that it will start with a few premises, go through a series of clearly reasoned arguments, and arrive at a clear conclusion at the end of the allocated time. And I hate to disappoint you from the beginning that that is not the way we will be proceeding. I must also say how intimidating it is to be at the university and talking to an audience such as yourselves. When I arrived, I was asked if I was talking about sound and the image, that of course I was taking part in the debate between Schopenhauer and Nietzsche. And I needed to explain, no, that Schopenhauer and Nietzsche had been asked to wait in the antechamber, and that people wishing to engage with them could meet them after the lecture, but that we would not be going in that direction at all. The lecture works in reverse. It starts from work in the studio, and then goes through a kind of reverse engineering to try to understand a possible interpretation of work that has been done, to try to find the thinking inherent in what the hand or the eye is doing in the studio. In this lecture or in this presentation, we go in two directions. We will start from work that exists in the studio and some reflections on what that could mean or what the origins of that could be. And then we will also go forward in the sense that part of the thinking about the questions I'll be addressing today will be looked at in a very practical sense here on stage. Anton Chekhov wrote that if you see a gun on the stage in Act One, you know in Act Three it's going to be used. And here we have a very beautiful double-barreled Steinway, and we have two excellent, an exponent of the piano and an exponent of the voice, and they will be joining me in due course. But before we get to the Winterreise, and before we get to the demonstration or the examination of some of the ways of thinking about sound and image, I want to go back several steps. There are two very different ways of approaching the world, which are simple and fundamental. The one is to think of a series of facts, to think of the world as a fact, a tree as a fact, like a photograph. Here it is, you understand it as a static thing. You can look at that for half an hour, it stays as it is. It is your time spent looking at that tree. The other way is to understand the world as a state, being in a state of provisionality. The world as existing in 25 frames per second. In which case you may look at a tree, but a tree is also understood not just as the tree, as the fact of the tree, but something, some moment in the transition between tree and timber and desk and book and pencil and flame and charcoal and smoke and ashes. And it has something to do with where we locate time in looking at the world. That is in some ways at the heart of the instability of sound and image that I want to talk about. So we have a static tree, and as I said, we can look at it for as long as we like, and we are aware that we are spending our time looking at the tree. But if we take that same image and we give it some hint of motion, a sense of something moving behind it, we're not looking at a single image, we're looking at the image 25 times every second, 25 frames a second. We become aware that it is not our time, that the time is somehow transferred into the image that we are watching. So there's a shift there. There's a way in which the image has to suffer the passage of time when it's in movement, whether it's static or whether it's moving itself, but the sense of the frames, the changing grain of the film, the flickering image, transports us from it being entirely our own generosity to give the time to the film itself demanding it from it. There's a way in which our refreshing of the image 25 times a second, the persistence of vision of the image sitting on our eye for a 25th of a second and then being refreshed all of the time and sitting there, that we are involved very directly in that construction of the illusion of movement and the construction of the illusion of the passage of time in the image. And this sense of our both complicity and our separation from what it is to construct the time, I think, is crucial in thinking about what does sound do to image, what is our connection to looking at a moving image or listening to a song and being involved with it or separated from it. So if we look at that same tree, now I did an exercise which was not slightly slower than it is here, it's slightly sped up here, which was going to sit in the garden to look at the tree which I was drawing and to try to make a list of the thoughts going through my head as I was spending time looking at the tree. So there was the sound of a hoopoe somewhere in the distance. There was thinking about the bark of the tree like someone's old skin. There was the distant sound of traffic like the ocean. There was the anticipation of rehearsals for the nose in New York. There was a kind of unspecified anxiety that arose. There was an looking at the ease of the tree's balance, an impulse to fix the structure of the tree, to draw the tree. I must make a swing for Emil, I thought. Syria, which I had not been thinking about till then. A memory of Ethiopian music. Two private thoughts, which are not to be described or repeated here. The branches of the tree like the brachii of a lung. Peripheral vision, my shoes, the book I was writing in. Images, thinking ahead to the lecture, to the piano in the lecture hall we would have here. The 53 years of the old age of the tree. The mortality of trees. I had to remember to buy whiskey the next day. A comparison, the companionship of the two ibises. A thought of anti-Zen. Anti-Zen. So those were the list of thoughts that were going through my head. And it's clear that already what we have here is an enormous separation between what one thinks one is doing when you're focusing, in this case, on the tree, and the fact that our mind is going in so many different ways. Particularly in this case, because it was such a static image, and one was sitting still and just watching the tree and allowing the thoughts to flow and go through us. And we have here also a contrast between the specificity of the image, the tree, the given, and the ambiguity of sound, the way in which a sound would come towards us and be expanded and think what it could associate to. There's a question of this unspecificity of sound and the very specificity of images that is key in trying to think of the relationship between music and sound when you're doing an opera, or in this case, thinking about a series of films for a series of songs. But to go to the first, back again to the beginning, I'll give you a list. Footsteps running, a door slams, a distant sound of a radio playing, a voice says, come in, sit down. There's a sound of paper, of machines, music from the radio, a crowd is shouting. There's a sound which is a train or paper moving in the street. So that list in itself is one way of hearing something and then having to translate it both into perhaps a visual set of images or a sound set of images, almost probably being very close to hearing, here is a list being given from the stage to us. But I want to test the difference between listening to sounds like that . And then exactly the same set of sounds, but projected over a very neutral non-film. So there I'm interested in the way in which, even though it's a non-film, there's no image, we're just looking at the pages turning in a book, there's something about the nature of the projected image which pulls that sound from being simply in our head or simply in the speakers and makes it hover somewhere between us and the screen, somewhere between where we are and what comes to us from the screen. And this for me becomes a very important point which we'll keep looking at further. The idea of the screen as a membrane, as an emblematic membrane of something halfway between the world and us. And it's very clear that in this example you have a very neutral set of pages of a dictionary turning in front of us. And the fact that we project onto that, or will onto that, some relationship of the sound to those pages, whether the paper turning quickly is what is making the pages turn. There's a desire which is almost irresistible to make a connection between the things we are hearing and seeing. And so we have to be aware very much of our activity, our agency in constructing that. Now, it's clear when we have sound in a film, there are three different ways in which the way in which that works. The first is the most obvious one of emotion. When there's a sad scene on the film, we have sad music and we understand how that. We have exciting scene, we have a chase, we have fast music, and those map together in a very direct and obvious way. A second way has to do with the grammar of a film, in which the starting or the ending or the punctuation of the music or the soundtrack acts as a kind of punctuation in the narrative, tells you what happens first, what causes something else. And there's a way certainly in helping us to read and construct a narrative or a set of order or logics in a film. But the third one is the one in some ways I'm most interested in. That has to do with the way in which the sound changes what we see, and what we see affects what we hear. So there are some times when there's an image which is so jerky that it seems unwatchable, but with the right kind of music it becomes smoothed out and changed. And this is the strange, unstable area where we think we have clarity and there is an objectivity. This film is going at a certain speed, but we cannot stop believing that its speed has changed and sped up or slowed down according to what we are hearing. This membrane that I'm talking about between the world and us is emblematic in a film, but it's also what happens in a drawing. When you have a set of marks on a sheet of paper, and both for the artist making it, but certainly for the viewer looking at it, there's a negotiation, there's an accommodation that happens between the world coming towards you on the sheet of paper, a rough drawing of an outline, and your projection, our projection onto that, saying, okay, these rough shapes make a horse, a rhinoceros. There's something in us that knows the shape of a horse or a rhinoceros, that fills in, that accommodates, and even as the shape becomes less and less clear, we are still willing it into being as that shape. And that's our meeting of the world halfway, and it's what happens obviously and emblematically in the studio in the case of drawing, or here very obviously in the case of projection, where we know there is a projection onto a screen and that is coming back to us and we are receiving it. But the larger point is, I think that although this is the obvious activity of the studio, it is a fundamental way that we always operate in the world. That whenever we think we have an understanding of something, it is always a mixture between what comes towards us and what we project onto it to construct a meaning. And it's this sense of constructing what comes towards us is the heart of what I'm interested in thinking about. What are the images we construct around a sound, and what is the sound that makes sense of certain images? Let's take another example. Again, this is a found piece of sound and a found set of images. The images are simply the turning pages of a 1907 La Russe encyclopedia, and the sound is a recording of a political meeting in a fish shop in Marseille in 1932. It's about 20 seconds long.
Alors, mesdames, vous savez que c'est aujourd'hui que nous faisons la réunion politique à la poissonnerie. La parole, que s'y va la parole?
À moi!
À moi! À moi, je demande la parole. Prends-la et sur une frondeleur de tire. Merci. La parole est à la citoyenne Pébon. Citoyenne, comme poissonnière, j'ai pas l'habitude de parler politique, mais puisque nous sommes réunis ici, je veux lâcher ma pétale comme les autres.
Silence!
Citoyenne, nous se plaignons que les affaires ne vont pas, c'est parce que nous payons trop d'impôts. Ça vient que nous sommes bouffés par les factionnaires, les fonctionnaires d'un côté, les factionnaires. C'est un tas de galavards qui nous prennent notre argent et qui servent de rien. Ça est la preuve, le sous-préfet. Je ne veux pas dire qu'il ne fasse pas plaisir lorsqu'il s'en va avec ton beau chapeau à cornes et ses brailles neuves dans les coulisses de la bricolo.
So, again, there's something about us that can't stop believing that somehow those words and that spittle is calling the images out of the pages as they go. Even in the sense where there's a random mapping of them on, there's no attempt to edit the pages to find the emphases, the moments of emphases. It's saying there's a enough of a fluidity in the synchronicity and in our reading of it and our construction of it to pull those gaps and pieces together. And this is obviously an important consideration in thinking, how does one work with images that relate to this very specific song cycle of the Winterreise? And there's one last example which I'd like to show before we get to the central section of the lecture. Another example of trying to test out, in this case, a constructed piece of sound, not a found piece of sound, and a constructed set of images, but again with the interaction between them fairly loose. It's also about 1 minute long.
The invention of Africa, Berlin, 1938. Nyasaland, 1915. Picasso on safari, Paris. Africa has been invented 6 times. The seventh invention of continental to share teaching does not please, shed our blood does not deserve to be a man. To flesh out the world time to realize government to green and even at that time, Africa was in big bulk suits, with the rich hats on the streets of the city, reading newspapers, living in small grass, but on land was skilled to the never get shot in the night, never come across, from the touch of the gay people from outside the only day, it was said of the slaves taken from Africa, waiting for the winner of the past, out of want and dire distress, proving his existential genetics, history, and the story. End of story.
End of story.
End of story.
So those are different examples of ways of trying to see what are the edges of working between sound and image. How far can it stretch from the logic? How far can one take meaning away from it? The set of almost random images going together with the exploded text of thinking about Africa, or the voice of the politician, or the sounds of the bird calls in the garden. And at this point, to take this one stage further, I should ask for volunteers in the audience, if there's anyone who can play the piano and who can sing, but more specifically, anybody who can play Dizzy Fingers by Zez Country, the great Illinois composer, or can sing Kern and Hammerstein's The Song Is You. So if I could ask Craig Terry and John Irvin from Ryan Opera to join me on stage. Here we get into the dangerous part of the lecture, in that a lot of it is, we met yesterday and we said, well, let's try a few of these different songs and a few different sets of images, but it's very much a testing out of things, so that the editing is wrong, the sync is wrong, the timing will be wrong, but this is very much the way it works in the studio, trying to find out the grammar of sound and image. We'll do this in two ways. We're going to look at sometimes the same images with very different music, and then later on, the same music with different sets of sound. The way the longer project of Winterreise proceeds, there's still a year before, or 9 months before that is produced, and I'm at the stage of trying to see what are the limits of the project. And this very kind invitation to come and use you as guinea pigs and join me in the testing of images came at the exact right moment in the project for me. So I'm enormously grateful to the Neubauer Collegium, Family Collegium, to the University of Chicago, and to my accomplices for testing this out. We're going to start with Kern and Hammerstein's The Song Is You.
I hear music when I look at you. The theme of every dream I ever knew. Down deep in my heart, I hear it play. I feel its sound, then melt away. I hear music when I touch your hand. Melody from some enchanted land, down deep in in my heart, I hear it say, is this the day? I alone have heard this lonely strain, I alone have heard this glad refrain. Must it be forever inside of me?
This is not a film that was made for that song at all. But he thought, let's try at the complete other end. How flexible are we in trying to somehow sew the song to the image? So here I'm going to ask Craig to play on his own. This, as I said, is Dizzy Fingers by Zez Country. So this was testing some of the outer limits. I mean, let it be said that there's an astonishing, and one of the points I want to keep coming back to is the extraordinary promiscuity of images, how they will sleep with so many different sets of sounds and still kind of work. And it's a question of how to judge what is the right degree of tension one can have between the image and the music and the words of the song and how loosely they can go. So I want to pause here to talk a little bit about Winterreise. The Winterreise project is overdetermined in several different ways. It started off as an invitation from a particular festival to do a work there, which initially was going to be a work about the First World War for the anniversary, and there was due to be a series of projections and stories and music, and at first I thought it would be the music of Poulenc or Satie, and then had a series of images and decided to look at these images with very different music. And one of the pieces of music we listened to was some Schubert. And suddenly found there was an astonishing an affinity between the rhythm of animation and the rhythm of pages turning at times and the piano music of Schubert. There was also an affinity between the length of an animated film, 4 to 7 minutes long, and the form of a song, the length of a song. So quite quickly the project turned into thinking about Winterreise. Again, not because I thought this is a project I need to start with or these are the images I have knowing the story of Winterreise, but discovering an unlikely collision. And the project continues as testing the edges and the possibilities of this unlikely collision. Now, the Winterreise itself, finished in 1827, that's a year before Schubert dies, and I think it's the year that Wilhelm Müller, the poet, dies. Both of their men dying at 31 and 33, respectively. And it's very much a poem with an anticipation of death in it. I mean, there are 24 songs. As David said, the surtitle, the subtitle to them is from the posthumous notes of a traveling horn player. But to go through the libretto very, very quickly. First song, Good Night. I came here a stranger, as a stranger I depart. The girl spoke of love, her mother even of marriage. Now the world is so gloomy, the road shrouded in snow. I write in passing on your gate, good night. The weather vane, the wind plays on the weather vane, on my lovely darling's house. The wind plays with the hearts inside, why does it on the roof, does as it does on the roof, only not so loudly. Frozen drops are falling down from my cheeks, how could I have not noticed that I had been weeping? I search the snow in vain for the trace of her steps. If my heart ever thaws again, her image will melt away too. At the well by the gate, there stands a linden tree, and its branches rustled as if they called to me, come here to me, my friend, here you will find peace. Many a tear from my eyes has fallen in the snow. It's burning under both my feet, even though I walk on snow and ice. I want to turn back and stand still before her house. Every river finds its way to the ocean and every sorrow to its grave. Now at first I notice how tired I am as I lay myself down to rest. I dreamed of many colored flowers. I dreamed of love reciprocated. Now I sit here alone and reflect on the dream. So I travel on my road, onward with sluggish feet. The frost has spread a white sheen on my hair. But soon it will melt away, and now I have black hair again, so that I am horrified by my youth. How long still to the grave. A crow has accompanied me since I left town. Crow, let me finally see loyalty unto the grave. The dogs are barking, the chains are rattling. I am finished with all my dreams. Why should I linger amongst the sleepers? Why do I avoid highways where other travelers go? I must travel a road from which no one ever returned. My way here has led me to a graveyard. What? All the rooms at this inn are full? Over there beyond the village, a strange old man. Shall I go with you? Will you play your organ to all my songs? So it's the story of a man who has been rejected by his mistress and makes his way through the winter, anticipating his death. The poems are fine, but they are not the greatest poems ever written. They are not poems which would say these have to be listened to 23 times every month in different halls around the world. And there's an important thing about the importance and the unimportance of the words, of the songs. For the singer, they're obviously completely vital. It is impossible to start to sing without fully accommodating and taking on all the responsibilities of all the words. But there's a different responsibility to us listening. I mean, very often, I'm sure you will have had the experience of hearing an opera and being completely emotionally swayed and followed by it, but being unable to distinguish syllable by syllable as the notes go into stratospheres or syllables are stretched out over 5 or 6 seconds. There's a deliberate and necessary deformation of language that happens between speaking and singing. And there is, of course, an enormous effort that can be placed into singing with such clarity that each of the words is heard. And this kind of contradiction between the need for perfect diction and clarity and its not need is very well encapsulated in an essay that Roland Barthes wrote about the grain of the voice, in which he, I think copying another philosopher, distinguishes between the phenosong, which is the song which focuses on diction, on the exact pauses, and on the perfect explication of the meaning of the words, and the genosong, which is much more the voluptuousness of the music, jouissance, as he describes it. And the unstable landing point of the desire we feel when we hear the music. The individual thrill of music, and particularly of the human voice. And for him, he does this in a distinction between the Swiss baritone Charles Ponzeras and for him, the evil man Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau, to whom I'm going to return. And I spent the last few days listening and looking at old YouTube pieces of Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau to see what I feel about it. I mean, Barthes' idea is that Dieskau is much too disembodied, he's too rational, he's too perfect, he takes away expression by arriving at vocal perfection. And there's a grain and embodiedness in Panzeras that he extols. But it's not quite that simple. There's certainly a way in which if you see the images of Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau, he's wearing a buttercream cardigan, he's got what look like nylon slacks, he's got his accountant's glasses. In the 1970s, to Barthes, he looked so square that he now has a kind of retro hipster cool to the way he is doing it. But also for Barthes, there was something of him being so well behaved, a sense of a German being very well behaved in the aftermath of the war, showing how one could arrive at emotion and song without the excesses that was felt in the Wagnerian music before the war. But it's also more than that. When he talks about the grain of his voice, I wonder if Barthes isn't in fact harking back to the grain in the pre-war recordings. He talks with disdain of what he calls the micro-groove recordings since the war, of the long-playing record, and longs for the much less stable sound of the 78 RPM records that Panzeras was recorded on. Much as we would now say we're not so happy with the flatness of a CD or digital recording and would like to go back to the very vinyl which Barthes was so disparaging about. So one has to understand not that the biography or the biographical is vital in accepting or not accepting the argument, but instead accepting the way in which the biographical and the personal reception of the music absolutely shapes what we project onto it. And I talk about Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau because for me the starting point of the project, apart from the invitation to do something at the festival in Vienna, was the memory of listening or of hearing, not so much listening to, of hearing the Winterreise played again and again by my father during my childhood. And it was the recording with Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau and with Gerald Moore hunched over the piano, also with his very transparent glasses sitting there completely focused on it. And there was something about the old memory of it, but not just that, the sense of it as a connection in this case both to my father and my mother. My father in the sense of somebody who loved Lieder and wanted to listen to it, and my mother who always chose to leave the room when and said that when she reached the age of 40, she hoped to be excused from any further Lieder concerts. So there was a sense always of a kind of attention in, was this beautiful music or was it absolutely so distant and so in love with the voice. There's somebody who wrote that with regard to poets, that love of word is love of self. And can certainly say that the love of sound with a singer becomes the love of self. And certainly for me, I find myself closer and closer to Barthes' extolling of the virtues of the bodily singing of the song, of how it reaches you, but it has to be done as if the words are completely vital. I think this is also a self-justification of growing up, as it were, in the colonies, in which opera in the pre-surtitle era was always heard uncomprehended. One would read the synopsis before each act and say, what are they singing about now? They seem angry. Okay, so this is where the father's shouting at the son for taking off. No, maybe not yet. He hasn't got to that yet. And this aria, is this the aria about the spring coming? Or is this the... And trying to map what you thought you were hearing onto what you could possibly remember. And on the one hand, it is a very bad way of listening. It doesn't do justice to the words and the text and what has been there. But it is not a way that stops one having a very direct and visceral connection to the idea of the music. And to get back now to the writing of the Winterreise, Schubert in the 1820s, one has to remember this is a different era from Beethoven. Beethoven was writing at the start of the Napoleonic era, when there seemed to be a heroic hope for the transformation of European society, for the rationality of the French Revolution to win through, for all the optimism, which starts with Mozart's magic flute, to find a home in the world. And it's afterwards. Mozart is writing afterwards. It's the time of reaction. One of his colleagues writes that the censorship in Vienna at that time was like a monkey we could not get off our backs. There was a sense of being very closely watched by the police, of Metternich's Europe closing down on everything. And the Schubertiades, those salons of gathering, of Schubert playing his music and friends playing his music, were in fact moments of domestic safety in what was otherwise a very demoralized world. There was an articulate but powerless public that made up Schubert's circle. And there was a way also in which that protected space of the chamber ensemble, of the small gathering, not the huge orchestral concerts, but the gathering in a room where the piano and the singer would perform, in which music also had a way of rescuing truth, of being outside of the bounds of having to watch what it said because the censorship was looking, the police spies were watching. And this truth had to do with two things. It had to do with, on the one hand, being open to allow emotions to emerge. But I think it also had to do with escaping the tyranny of meaning. There's a way in which one can read a sentence and understand the meaning of a sentence. But what is the meaning of a line of piano? What is the meaning of one movement of a sonata? There's a way in which one cannot pin it down. And there's a way in which the music and the songs also resist being reduced to the meaning of the songs, of the words, of the text. And I think it's in this resistance that I'm interested in trying to follow the track. And I'm doing this out of necessity. I started off thinking I'm going to do the Winterreise. I need to draw winter landscapes. I need to draw snow. I need to draw trees that the man is walking past these trees. We need to have the lover. We need to draw a German house of the 1820s. And I got completely stuck. It was a different language, it was a different way of thinking, and there was nothing that emerged at all. The best it would have been an illustration of the songs, and at the worst would have been a kind of an emptiness, I suppose. So the starting point was very different. It was saying, what happens if we smash, in some sense, the music that is there in the words and in the song, together with fragments of film that exist, films that I've made in the past, films I'm working on now, and see if there is a rapport both in terms of rhythm, in terms of how the images and the music fit together, but also thematically in the themes which Schubert has, because he's talking about several things. He's talking about personal longing. He's talking about it in his own sense, the narrative of the person going through the journey, anticipating death, going from one bad state to the next. It's a kind of a, in addition to this actual physical journey, there's a private longing of the heart about a desperation, about a grief. And that's obviously something that's much closer and transports to wherever one is and doesn't have to be set in the snows of Vienna. And then there's the end of the Republican ideal, the way in which, although it's not an explicit subject in the songs, is certainly there in their composition, in the end of a kind of idealism, in the separation between what the voice is doing and what the piano is doing, that for me became another kind of key to say, well, the work that I've been doing in Johannesburg in the 1990s and in the last decade, can this completely different world map? What is the relationship between Vienna, where these songs are written, and Johannesburg in South Africa? And one of the obviously connection was, yes, they did make a connection. As a child, I remember being completely held by the strangeness of the words and the voice, the kind of music that was across this enormous divide. So there was a test to say, can one bring the landscapes back to South Africa? There's something about the form of the music and the walking rhythms that go through so many of the songs, and the walking rhythm that is part of the practice of being in a studio. This relationship of walking to thinking. One thinks of the promenade of the aristocratic estates in which philosophers would walk up and down talking and thinking, and one thinks of the passeggiata of the 19th century bourgeois city, which people would walk up and down after lunch, also as a public space for thinking, and the kind of loss of this public walking and thinking. It's now replaced by that both most abject activity, our devotion to the gym, where we move, and very often we don't even, we have a treadmill that moves for us, and we have a television set in front of us that thinks for us. So there's a sense, there is a nostalgia back to that sense of walking and thinking as a theme that goes through the songs and has been part of my thinking of the material. But what became clear was that it needed an Alice in Wonderland approach to the music. That is to say, in Alice in Wonderland, when Alice is trying to reach the door at the back of the hall, as she walks in that direction, she realizes she's getting further and further away from it. It needs her to turn her back to walk in a completely different direction, and she suddenly finds she's at the door. It's the test today is to see whether that way of working with images and films that were made completely for a different purpose, films that were made 20 years ago, fragments made for other songs, other music, can somehow find their place with the Schubert. So there are four songs that we're going to, that John Irvin is going to kindly sing and Craig Terry will play. And one of them we are going to do three times. But we will start with the first song, Gute Nacht, which functions as a kind of table of contents of the song cycle that is going to follow. So if we could. Wieder aus, der Mai war mir geworden. Thank you. Thank you. We're going to look at the song Das Wirtshaus. And the Wirtshaus is the story, the traveler has gone to a graveyard and it's like an inn, and he realizes there are no vacancies at this inn, and so he has to keep on walking. And this is the song we were looking at yesterday in three different ways of thinking about it. And the whole project is still at the stage of trying to say what are the kinds of images that work, and then the long learning the grammar of what the piece is, the grammar of how the images talk to the music and to the words, and find a coherence that's neither an illustration of the songs, nor that is completely divorced from them. So, Now we're going to do that song again, not to correct the singing, but to look at it in a very different way of thinking. There's something about when the song expands and the music expands really slowly, much like looking at the tree at the beginning of the lecture. It's sometimes in that very slowness that there's the gap and the space for a whole range of different thoughts and images to appear, and that very contradiction of speed between a really slow music and a fast image becomes a new possibility as a way of thinking. And so that's the next way we want to look at the piece. I want to pause for one moment here to talk a little bit about the process in the studio, which is kind of what you're seeing here. It has to do with the nature of repetition, of finding an impulse, in this case trying to track down what the images do to the music as we're listening to it, and understanding that the work in the studio is then the repetition, the learning of the grammar, the going over and over and seeing how things work. And it is, as we're doing it here, listening to the song time and time again, and we're going to listen to it not again and again, but one more time, to see a very different kind, a much more narrative approach to exactly the same song. And we're going to conclude with the one of the last songs. And here the images I'm testing are at the extreme edge. It's a kind of a heroic song. As everything is getting worse and worse, there's a moment of heroic hope he has that everything will turn out okay, which we know is a false hope in the cycle of songs, in the psychology of the person. So it's testing, can one stretch all the other way? On the basis that people will be hearing the words, they'll be understanding what they are, but our ability to sew things together across enormous distances, across huge gaps, to encompass not a purity of looking, but a fractured way of looking and encompassing the world, that we construct a coherence from so many different contradictory elements, which we somehow pull not just into what we look or what we read, but into how we construct ourselves from the different impulses we have that contend within it, from which we construct what appears to be a coherent single subjectivity. And the idea in the song, and in this song in particular, is to say, how far can one stretch that acknowledgement of construction, of fragmentation, without losing any sense of, without losing ultimately a sense of meaning? So we're going to finish this evening with the song Mut, Courage. One encore. It's a concert. I won't give you another paragraph. This is the song which is described as the most famous in the repertoire of German art songs. Thank you.
ich muss auch heute wandern vorbei in tiefe Nacht. Da hab ich noch im Dunkeln die Augen zugemacht und sah
good. Thank you.